Welcome back everyone to the tutorial series. Today we are going to talk about everything regarding contracts. We're specifically going to talk about composer contracts. There are many other contracts we can talk about, but that's for a different video. Today it's just about composer agreements. There are as many different contracts as there are projects. Every contract is different and I am no legal professional. So if you're looking for actual legal advice, please seek out an actual entertainment lawyer. I am not that. But of course, I've seen my fair share of actual contracts on my own projects and other people's projects. And so I can at least talk about the most common things that I see in there. So every contract starts out with very basic information. The two parties that the contract is made between are introduced by name, the companies are introduced, the addresses, everything that identifies the two parties will be on the first page. And you will also have the project title, the working title, you know, some movie specifications or specifications about whatever project this is. Can also be a video game or a TV show. All of that will be specified on the first page. Then the second part will always be about your services. What are you being hired for? What is your main job description and what is expected of you? Now, usually it says something along the lines of write, produce, and deliver X amount of music, but it can also specify a lot of other things. It can include other supervising tasks that are expected of you. It can include conducting and music editing, though these are usually separate contracts because the budget for those comes out of a different sub-budget of the production. Music editing comes out of the editing budget normally, and conducting comes out of the recording budget. It can say that you're in charge of any third-party hires. It can specify that you need to be at the dub mix. It can specify that you're supposed to supervise the recording and mixing process. It can specify that you're in charge of the final file delivery and such things. And then another thing that is in there is usually the expected amount of music that you are supposed to deliver and in what kind of format you're supposed to deliver. This part can also include possibly song arrangements if there are songs in the film and you're expected to do orchestral arrangements for them. It can generally also include song production if the movie actually needs original songs. So basically any type of service that is expected of you will be in that paragraph. Then there's usually also another paragraph about music budget allocation. It'll usually specify what the overall music budget is and how it is divided up. It'll also say who's in charge of what. Sometimes the composer is in charge both of their own internal budget but also the recording budget. Sometimes it's a package fee, so it's up to the composer what gets spent on what aspect. Sometimes, or in my case very often actually, the production will keep the recording budget and just give me my creative fee and whatever other services I'm in charge of. And then they will keep the recording budget and distribute that. There's often also a clause about third-party hires, that you're allowed to hire additional help internally at your studio and that you are basically in charge of those people, not just supervising them, but also making sure they sign NDAs, release forms, and all the stuff that is necessary for the production to eventually distribute the product. There can also be a clause about production requests, what is considered a reasonable request, and if specific out-of-the-ordinary requests require extra budget, that this has to be renegotiated. It also specifies who your point person is, how communication happens. It specifies what kind of score is expected of you. Sometimes it says an orchestral score, sometimes it says a hybrid score, sometimes they're expecting a synthesized score. That they have to give me feedback in a reasonable amount of time. Often they specify how much time can pass between me sending music and them responding, so that I'm always able to still deliver on time. But it also says in that paragraph, in no vague terms, that this is work for hire and that obviously, since they are paying you, you have to write music according to the spotting notes and according to their feedback, their revision notes. You have to address it to create the kind of music that they are asking for. So they're making sure that you can't just go ahead and write whatever you want, of course. Then there's usually a chapter about the creative fee, which is the fee that the composer gets to keep. That doesn't mean that the creative fee is always just for you. It can mean that that includes your facilities, your studio, your general running costs. This includes your time, your skills. This includes mock-up deliveries. This includes session prep, usually for me, orchestration deliveries, supervising the entire music department. I mean, it can mean a lot of things. I usually also pay the additional writers out of my creative fee. They don't come out of the recording budget, of course. So anyone I hire to help me at my studio comes out of my creative fee. And also the fee for your agent would also come out of the creative fee portion of the budget. They don't usually take money out of the recording budget. There's usually also an extra paragraph about payment terms of that creative fee. Usually what I see is 50-50, so you get 50% of the fee upon signature of the contract, and then you get the other 50% once you deliver the final files. There are also some contracts I've had where it was 30-30-40. So you get 30% of the fee upon signature, and then you get another 30% halfway through, and then you get the remaining 40% upon delivery of the final material. It also specifies where the invoice has to go, and they are not usually withholding taxes. Sometimes with international productions, you need to get tax exemptions and such. But this will all be specified in that paragraph. Usually what it says is there will not be any taxes withheld, and it's basically the composer's responsibility to make sure that they pay all federal and state taxes themselves. There is usually an extra clause about unions, and I think LA musicians in particular, or maybe their union, don't quite understand that we do have clauses in our contracts that specifically state that you are not to work under a union agreement, that you are not to hire anyone under a union agreement. So you get your creative fee, and the production pretty much makes sure with this paragraph that they will not ever be liable for anything else other than what they are paying you. So it's not really a choice that we have. It's just how it is. Then there's an extra paragraph about contingent compensation, which basically specifies royalty income. So it will tell you what your entitlements are to what percentages of the ownership of the music. Usually you keep the writer's share and they get the publisher's share, unless it's a low budget production, in which case you can negotiate the publisher share for yourself as well. But in general, it'll specify who owns what percentage and what kinds of royalties you can collect with that. Mechanical royalties, public performances, synchronization rights, soundtrack sales to sheet music sales, everything is in there where you would get a share of the sales or the performance royalties because you own a percentage of the music that is being played. Then if it's not a package deal, there's a paragraph about the recording budget. It basically states what the production will pay for out of the recording budget. So this is basically just a paragraph saying the composer is not responsible for all of these costs, which is usually any stage costs, any musician costs, orchestration, the score editing, sometimes the score mix, anything that happens with regards to recording, the copyist, the librarian, I mean, you name it. Anyone who is on that side of the production gets paid out of their budget, and so you're not responsible for that. Unless it's a package deal, in which case that will be specified in your creative fee that this is an all-in fee and that you have to pay everything out of that. Then there's an extra paragraph about credit. Some people don't know how very specific that paragraph can be, but it basically describes the wording of your credit that you're going to get. It's usually music by or original score composed by, something like that. Whatever you choose, really. Where in the credits or the main titles your name is going to appear, and that it's going to be the same font and font size as everyone else, and where your name appears in the credit roll, on the poster, in the trailers, any type of marketing. And something that I always put into my contracts as well is that I'm in charge of also delivering the music department credits, because I always want to make sure nobody's forgotten on my team, because boy have I been there many times where I have worked on a production for months and then, you know, my name wasn't in the credits, and it's a bit, you know, hurtful. It leaves a bitter aftertaste, and I don't want that for my team, so I usually put it in my contract that I will deliver a list of names, and those names have to be in the credit roll, if possible. I do the same with the music cue sheets. I always have an extra paragraph in there that says that the composer gets to approve the final cue sheet delivery. Very often, I'm actually the person creating them, so I do have the control over that. But this is the same reason I've been left off of cue sheets and other people have, and that's not okay. And so I want to do better with my own team and also for myself, make sure everything is accurate. And so I get final approval of the cue sheet, but very often I will create it myself and I will also give it to all of my additional writers for their archives and for them to proofread to make sure everyone gets exactly what they deserve. There's usually a paragraph about the term of the agreement, which basically is just describing when you're supposed to start and when the term ends. It's usually kind of a fluid process, so it's kind of good to have that in the contract where it says, okay, upon signature of the contract, you officially start, and upon delivery of these files, you're officially done and you can invoice us. Then you have a rather large paragraph for the rights of the production. This is important for them mainly because they obviously need to lay out what kind of license they are acquiring and what their exploitation rights are for your music. So it has to specify, is it an exclusive license? Is it a non-exclusive license? What territories can they distribute your music to? What franchises and media can they use it for? Pretty much anything that they need permission for is in that paragraph. It also allows them to grant rights to third parties, which sometimes they have to do if, for example, maybe the production is not the distributor at the same time, so they have to have the ability to transfer licensing rights to other people. And then another clause that is very often in there is one that specifies what music they are talking about, because sometimes you have pieces that got rejected on the production, so they need to specify if they're talking about ownership and licensing rights for everything that you created during the production on their time and their money, or if you actually get to keep the rights and the licensing and everything for rejected music that they didn't actually put in the movie. Ideally, you maintain the rights to rejected music because it means you can use it again or publish it yourself, I mean, whatever you want to do with it. But there are some productions that basically say, hey, everything you produce while you're working on this is ours. Everything you send to us is automatically ours. And that's perfectly valid too. Then there's usually also a clause about your name and likeness, which basically gives them the right to use your name and your face for any type of advertising, for the movie, for any media related to this. And it also usually has a clause about, you know, behind the scenes media that is allowed to feature you and such, because, you know, obviously you need to give them permission to do that. There's often some legal clause as well that you have read and understood the agreement, that you agree with everything and that what you're doing is legal, meaning you're not infringing on anyone else's copyright, that in good faith you can say you wrote original music, and that you also vouch, obviously, for your team to have done that, that you got all the release forms and permissions from them to sell the music, anything that could get anyone into legal trouble. You also need to sign that whatever you do is in compliance with any existing labor law, of course, in whatever jurisdiction you are operating your studio. There's a separate thing for NDAs. Sometimes it's an actual separate document that you sign, but very often it's just a separate page inside the contract that is basically specifying what is considered confidential information, what is considered trade secrets, and you of course also have to have everyone on your team sign a similar NDA. You can just either copy that exact text or have your own studio NDA, but everybody needs to understand that you're handling sensitive material that if not handled well, it can cost the production a lot of money, and so it needs to be handled accordingly. This paragraph also specifies how a breach is to be handled, but that's usually dictated by the production, what you are supposed to do if you got hacked or one of your team members was, you know, a little too loose with their security or something got posted. Whatever it is, they will tell you in that paragraph what you're supposed to do in that case. There's also an important clause that is strangely important right now, which is force majeure. It's basically a clause that says when anything happens that is outside of your control, you are free from the restrictions and rules of this agreement. Basically, if there's a global pandemic, you might not have to deliver on time anymore. As it happened with my production and pretty much anyone else's production. Currently, the schedules have shifted, but also anyone who had live recording scheduled, like I did, I obviously couldn't comply with my contract anymore because, first of all, we weren't allowed to travel. I couldn't fly over and fulfill the conducting part of my agreement. We couldn't get an orchestra. We had to record in a completely different way. All of this falls under force majeure. But we're basically talking anything that is not in your control. In LA, for example, it's also very important to have that clause because we do have earthquakes and it can happen. It can damage equipment or interrupt your work for an extended period of time. There are also massive brush fires that get people evacuated for extended periods of time. So all of that is not considered a breach of contract. There's usually also a paragraph or even an extra page about deliverables. So what kind of delivery is expected of you, what kinds of files, what kind of content, what file formats, everything that has to do with the final delivery of your material is specified in that paragraph. And then there's a ton of miscellaneous stuff. One thing I see a lot is the no reassignment clause, that you are not allowed to assign your contract or your duties to a third party without checking with the production first. It specifies how amendments to this agreement need to be made, and it also determines the no obligation to produce, which basically means even if you deliver the entire score and they approve it and they take it, there's no obligation on their part to actually use your music. If they decide later on to discard everything and get someone else and replace your entire score, they absolutely can. It specifies the composer's performing rights organization details. In my contracts, it also usually says something about the soundtrack album, not just who has the soundtrack rights, but also that I get the first right to produce the album mixes and the album edits, and that I can also provide a label if the production doesn't have a label they want to publish with. So I usually put that into my contract because I do want everything I do to be published eventually. It also specifies that you are covered under their insurance. It'll say anything about what kinds of copies, DVD copies, CD copies, poster copies that you're getting. It'll specify anything about the premiere, how many people you can take, all that kind of stuff, travel costs, not just for the premiere, but also travel costs for the production itself. If you have to move outside a certain radius to your studio, then they have to pay for travel and accommodation, and then it'll specify if they have to pay for, you know, first class, economy class, whatever. And one thing that I learned from some of the composers I've worked for is a clause that I always put in these days. It's the first right to negotiation, which basically says if there are sequels to what you're doing right now, or prequels or spin-offs in any type of way, you get first dibs, basically. They have to approach you first and offer it to you, and then if you can't reach an agreement with them or you don't want it, then they can go and find someone else. Then there's usually one or two pages that are just describing anything legal, anything regarding the jurisdiction and laws that apply in this case. That's kind of the part that you really want a lawyer to look over. But in general, I would advise you to have, if you have a bigger contract where there's actual, you know, money involved, it's probably advisable to have a lawyer look over it. And then at the very end, you have the exhibits that are usually referenced in some of the sections. Exhibit A is usually, in my contract at least, a release form that basically says, I hereby transfer the rights to XYZ and give them permission to exploit the work according to this contract. It's also the one that you have to give to your additional writers if they wrote anything and they own a portion of the product. So it's basically a certification of sorts, where you also once again reiterate that this is your original work and that the production can't be held responsible for it if you stole anything. Then there's usually Exhibit B, which is outlining the scheduling, what kinds of production milestones are expected. This is usually fairly loose. These are not usually hard deadlines, but rather kind of a general outline of what they expect from you in terms of delivery. The really hard deadlines are the recording sessions and the dub stage delivery, because those don't move. And if you don't deliver those files on time, then there are actual damages. And then the last exhibit in my contracts usually is Exhibit C, which is outlining the technical specifications of your delivery, bit rate, kilohertz rate, surround format, what kinds of stem splits are required. Usually they also attach a document from the scoring stage that is outlining further how they want the files delivered. So it's kind of cross-referencing that, but just so, you know, you're on the same page. There are, of course, many more details and perks you can put in there depending on your status as a composer, but also depending on the production budget, of course, the size of the production. The bigger studios will have a lot more details in there. But these are the most common things that you will probably find in every professional production contract. These are the main points that should be covered, even though, as I said at the beginning, there are as many contracts as there are projects. Every single one is different. So always read through it. Have your agent look over it. Have an entertainment lawyer look over it. Have your manager look over it. Whoever is savvy in your surroundings, have them take a look. I hope this was helpful. It's not the most exciting topic, but it does need to be talked about because a lot of people are asking about this online a lot of the time. You can also find contract templates online for this on various Facebook forums, and I'm pretty sure there are other places where people have made their templates public. And if you want more content like this, like and subscribe.